good afternoon. My name is Uzma, and I am from Toronto, Canada. So, actually, let me just make sure I get that up here first. All right, there we go. Okay, so from across the border, I have an American passport, so don't hold the Canadian thing against me. I just moved to Toronto about 2 years ago. So you'll see a lot of it is, there's a little bit of Canadian language in there. No, not A or any of that, but in terms of grade levels, in terms of the background, it's a little bit Canadian. So if there's anything that you do not understand at the very end, you can feel free to ask. I do mix up the American and Canadian because I spent most of my life in the U.S. So there will be some American and Canadian acronyms throughout. Okay? So what I'm here to talk to you a little bit about today is the importance of early intervention and screening. And I'll go ahead and transition once I briefly talk about the importance of it and talk about our program that we have, which is called the Web-Based Teaching Tool. Okay, so basically, what is early screening and intervention? We're going to talk about screening first off, and that's pretty much, it's administering a brief screening measure. So it's not an assessment, we're not at that part yet. We're talking about figuring out where the kids stand in their early years. So primarily kindergarten through grade two, but it's most common kindergarten and grade one. Okay, and we just want to determine, are they at risk for future school difficulties? We're not in any way diagnosing, it's not a diagnostic tool that diagnoses LDs or that sort, and there is a common misconception that our tool does that. But it's a universal screening program that screens all kids to see if they're going to have, if there's a likelihood that they're going to have struggles in the future. Okay, and then early intervention. So now we figure out, are students struggling? If they are, the whole purpose is not to stop there. Great, we know that they need help, but now we need to perform interventions and intervene. So what does the research show? So most of us here are here for the early years, and we understand that there's not only are there sponges, but if they do need that early intervention, that early support, then it's really important that we hone in on those early years. So here it says, child development research indicates that learning and development is most rapid in pre and early school years. As a result, screening intervention should begin as early as possible in order to detect children who are struggling and eventually enhance their development. Okay. So there are many factors and many variables that can affect student achievement. Many of those are such we've heard before, emotional and behavioral problems, socioeconomic status, parental involvement or lack thereof, can contribute to a student's potential for academic failure. But since there are so many variables that can contribute, we want to make sure that we're figuring out there's got to be a benchmark. So when kids come in, we need to do direct screening measures. And this is through direct screening methods. And we'll talk a little bit more about that later on. Okay, so what does the research show right now? In a typical classroom, between 15 to 20% will be at risk for future school failure if they do not receive that early intervention and support early on. So that's why we're really focusing on that early stage. So it decreases that achievement, that gap. So by the time that they're in third grade, and if they haven't received that support early on, there's going to be that really large gap, and it's going to be very hard for them to catch up with their peers. Okay, so three of the critical screening areas that I'm going to be talking about are school readiness. So are kids ready for school in general? And we'll elaborate a little bit more on that later. Phonological awareness, which is under the umbrella of early literacy development. And of course, last but not least, is math. Okay, so school readiness. If children who are at risk for future school failure or difficulties are identified and supported early on, the odds of them failing can substantially be reduced. And that's our goal. There's always going to be a handful of students that no matter what we try to do, they may not be able to catch up for certain reasons. And those we'll talk about later on are those who are eventually, you know, identified with an IEP or with a specific learning disability. But there are a really large group of kids that if we do provide those interventions early on, they will be likely not to fail later on in the school years. Okay, so phonological awareness, which is the second area of screening. We've heard a lot about this term, and we've heard it in presentations from many of you and the presenters earlier on. This is critical because not only is it strongly related to success in reading and spelling acquisition, but it's also a strong predictor for, it's a necessary prerequisite for success in learning to read. And it is known as a top predictor in reading success. And in fact, an interesting fact is that it's a predictor of reading success better than anything we know, including the IQ. So here's a little chart of the continuum, listening being the most simple step, and then phonemes, which is the most complex and challenging for children. And our screenings do address all these steps, and I will talk about the screenings a little bit later on in the presentation. Okay, and the last area of screening is math. So fluency is critical because it's a basic calculation, and it's important to for solving the higher level skills such as problem solving. And math is a hierarchical skill, so it's really important to build that foundation, and that's why we have screenings in this area, and we address that. Some of these references and sources, some of them are Canadian, some of them are American, so there's both in there. Okay, the DSIM, this is the Dynamic Screening and Intervention Model that we base a lot of our studies and our screenings align with this. And the first step in this model is screening. Ignore the tracking progress right now because that's really the fourth when it comes back to the circle and it closes it. So screening is critical. We start off with screening. So which are the students that do need that extra support? And then once we've screened them, we find out, okay, are they flagged or not flagged? And flagged basically means they're at risk, and not flagged means they're not, that they're achieving at the benchmark or above. Okay, and if they're flagged, what do we need to do? We need to provide an intervention. So that's where we really tie the two together. We make sure that those who are flagged are receiving interventions, and then from the interventions, once they're performed or given to the child, it goes back and we track progress, so progress monitoring, which is a term many of us are familiar with. So that model is very critical, and now we'll talk about the importance of it. So why do we have the DSIM model? So it increases student achievement and reduces future academic difficulties because we're going from step one through step four, and we're following the continuum. It also helps teachers implement data-driven instruction. So data is not the purpose of our tool, but it is it's a huge benefit. So you'll notice once we get into it, it's all online-based. So teachers have that data accessible, but the whole purpose in screening and interventions is not just to get that data. It's of course, to help the kids. And last but not least, it ensures those struggling students receive that extra support. A lot of times what happens is those ones who need the most support, you know, are kind of just pushed back, and maybe they're given activities on a different level, but we're really not following up with them to see how much they're improving and progressing. Ooh, there it comes. Okay, so the response to intervention model, that's the other one. This is very common. It's a popular model. It's been, I think, there's 20 years of research. It's back to 20 years of research. And this is a tiered approach. So tier one is just high quality classroom instruction. So every student gets the same quality instruction, and their universal screenings. Okay, now when we go to tier two, that's when we see, okay, there's targeted interventions for flagged students. So all those students, every student that was screened in tier one, those students who are struggling and flagged receive a second level of intervention. Going from tier two to tier three, that's a higher level, and that's a little bit more serious. So those students who may have taken two or three interventions and are incompletely or unsuccessfully fulfilling the intervention's goals, they're going on to tier three. And this is where, you know, the classroom teacher would talk to the parent and to maybe the school psychologist and go for a further psychoanalysis assessment. So the DSIM and the RTI, both of them, to be successful, we need to have high classroom quality instruction. Two is there's ongoing student screening or assessment. Three is the tiered instruction, which we talked about, the RTI model. And last but not least, which is very critical, is having parental involvement. And then going back to number two, the ongoing student screening. It's very important that students, all of them, are screened. Sometimes, of course, we all have, as teachers, there's so much going on that you may want to just jump to those students that are already, something is going on, and I want to see what it is. And when we do that, a lot of times those students kind of fall through the cracks, the ones that are in between, and we may not necessarily catch that. So we're really, really all about the universal screening and making sure we screen at least twice a year for all students. So even if a student is not flagged the first in the fall, that doesn't mean they will not be flagged in the spring. Okay, so what is the web-based teaching tool? I'm going to refer to it as Webit because it's a mouthful. So what we are, it's a bilingual English and French. It's universal, so not LD specific. It's universal for all early year children. And it's an online program. When I say it's an online program, this is for the use of primary teachers to use in their classrooms. And this is JK to grade one. JK, it's not just kidding, it's junior kindergarten. Junior kindergarten, SK, senior kindergarten, grade one. We do have screenings for grade two, but it's really Dibbles, which many of you may be familiar with. And that's available upon request, because grade two is not as common for the early years. I know our government, our ministry really emphasizes on JK through grade one. And grade two is at that cusp of, is it early years or are they already, past that stage? But we do offer that. And so it's primary teachers use this in their classrooms, and it's a tool for them, not the children. Okay, so what are our program goals? It's really what we're all here for today, to increase student achievement in any way that we can, to close the early achievement gap. So, a child is suffering earlier on. If they continue to struggle without that extra intervention, by grade three, grade four, it's almost too late. We want to get there early so that that way when they're in grade three, they're caught up to all their peers. Okay, and it's basically to support the classroom-based model. So screenings, intervention, and progress monitoring are taking place by the classroom teacher. And then, very important, this program helps differentiate students with learning difficulties with those requiring extra support. So really differentiates the tier two to tier three. So some students may just need a little push and that help, and they'll be caught up. Other students may be, there's something more serious. So it may very well be an LD or something of that sort, but it's not diagnostic. And of course, to provide additional support to children who need it as early as possible. Okay, so the step one, there's four steps throughout our program. Step one is a screening. So here's examples of different screening tools that are used to measure school readiness, phonological awareness, and math. One is an example over there of the TSRI, which is the Teacher School Readiness Inventory, and that's purely observational. And that is a document where the teacher would walk around and observe over the course of a time. Some teachers do it over 3 weeks, 4 weeks, and that's normal. So, and that, the TSRI talks about, there's five different areas. I have to read it from here because, of course, when I'm up here, I'll forget it if I don't have it written down. So the five areas are in-class distractibility, attention and memory span. Two is verbal fluency, and that's shown right over here. Three is interest and participation. Four is letter identification skills. And last but not least is printing skills. So throughout different assignments, the teacher is monitoring, and that's a screening in itself. And that's basically, is the child ready coming into school? Okay, phonological awareness. This is an example of Rossner. Rossner is the name of a screening. It's the Rossner Auditory Analysis Task. And this is an example of, okay, first say cowboy, the student will say cowboy. Okay, now say it again, but don't say boy. So it's deletion, and it gets from A to, from A through, from 1 through 13, it gets from easy to more challenging. And there's benchmarks within the program that automatically are entered before the teacher even screens. So the teacher screening, and they get 6 out of 13 right, that it, depending on that age group, it'll be a cutoff. And that's what will determine if a student is flagged or not. So the first step is screening. Here's just an little synopsis of the screening tools and for what grade levels. So we have JK, SK in grade 1. There is something for each except for the JK phonological awareness. We don't have anything right now. Our currently our research advisory working group, we're always looking for different screenings that would pertain to this age level. What we're finding is a lot of times it's developmentally, it's not appropriate to screen that early for that area. So, and then grade 2, of course, upon request. So the teacher school readiness inventory, the TSRI, I already talked about that a little bit. But this research was done by Dr. Marvin Simner, and the TSRI preschool teachers were able to identify nearly 85% of the children in their classes by the end of grade 2 had either repeated a grade or had been placed in some form of special education class. So these screenings are really helping, because just by observing, they can tell, and through the direction of our screenings and programs in place, which students had something a little bit more serious before coming into grade 2. Okay, so when the reliability was just tested, there's a lot of research being done and that it has been done, but I didn't want to put all of it in here because it'll take days to go through it all. But the reliability was just previously tested in the fall of last year, and it showed very good reliability. For those of you that may not be familiar, the closer to 1, the better it is. So when tested against other TSRI areas, screening areas, it was quite high. Okay, phonological awareness, this is for SK. So as you saw the list before, phonological awareness, there's an SK and then there's a grade 1 specific screening. So in the, versus the TSRI, it's SK, grade 1, those are the same screenings for all the grade levels, just different cutoffs, different benchmarks. Okay, and so this was a collection. This is an American screening. And the reliability was assessed in Western Pennsylvania, and it was also assessed using the Stanford Achievement Test. We're currently working on getting the exact numerical data in place. But it is shown to be very effective. The phonological awareness is the grade 1 specific screening, and this one was 0.95, and this one's very high. Teachers were getting, it's resonating very well with the teachers, and they're showing it to be very effective in helping them see whether or not they're struggling in phonological awareness. Okay, math, this was done, this is more Canadian-based, and this is a math screen that was developed for Webbit itself, and we used several different things, longitudinal studies, input from teachers, researchers, and specifically the Ontario curriculum. And this is one of our screens as well. And with the math screen, that is separate for JK, SK, and grade 1. So they're all different screens. Okay, so step 1 was the screenings in those different areas. And step 2 is the flagging. So I've been referring to that a lot, and all it means is a student is flagged when they are at risk for future school difficulties. So in a class, it could be anywhere from 5 out of 20 students or 10 out of 20 students. And once they're flagged, it goes on to the next step, and step 3 is interventions. So what our program does, this is a little bit how it looks right here. It provides a database of interventions that are searchable. So here, for example, if you have a child that is struggling specifically in verbal fluency, you would select verbal fluency. Then there's criteria you can select, which is which grade level are they in, what group size. So is it whole class instruction? Is it one-on-one, small group? And you can select the criteria. And once you enter that information, it'll basically pull up a database of interventions that meet that criteria you selected. So the more specific, the fewer interventions. Together, we have almost 600 interventions, which are all research-based, and they've been highly effective. We've got a lot of good feedback on these interventions, and we hope to add more to it once we get some more research on that. And just going back to the intervention piece, it's a really huge benefit for teachers. We all know lesson plans can be really cumbersome, and then there's modifications, and for a group of 20 students, you may have to develop several, depending on one-on-one or whole class instruction. So the beauty about this is the interventions are basically lesson plans, and currently they're meeting the Ontario Ministry's expectations. And this can always be changed. Right now we're working with other provinces, for example, BC, that has BC-specific expectations. And that can always be, and we'll be modifying our system to include that. Okay, so the last step is continual monitoring. So interventions, they help track students' progress. We also have observation checklists. So in between the two screening periods, so between fall and spring, there's that really large gap. So if they're not screening, what are the teachers doing? We have checklists that help determine strengths and the needs throughout that time. So that way that there is a paper trail, if anything, that they're saying, are they improving in 3 months, 4 months, 5 months, however long it takes up until the next screening period. Okay, this is just a little bit about what it looks like when you log on. We right now, teachers can have their own accounts, principals have their own accounts. They see aggregate data of their school. Board contacts, which we call them, are really district personnel, I guess would be the comparable here, and secretaries. Secretaries can log in because they can enter information for the teachers, which really saves them time, and they can spend more time screening versus doing some of the more administrative tasks. So we have all that, and then about Webbit, you can learn a little bit more about our program and the overview. Okay, so this is what a class profile looks like. You take a look at Jamie Brown right here, she's got a flat circle and then a green circle. The flat circle means when she first took the TSRI, she was flagged as at risk. She had three interventions, you see right there, the number three under the green check mark. And that shows that she took three interventions, they were each successful. She has one current intervention that's incomplete, which is why the arrow is half full. And then there is a green circle, which is for she took the TSRI again, and she was successful. So she completed that. And that's a class profile. Now, if you go down to the next tab, it's student profile. So here's Jamie Brown. She is, it talks about her first screening. She received a 7 out of 25. And you can see right there the different numbers, the criteria. She got a 1 out of 5, for example, in in-class distractibility. So it really hones in on the specific areas. And then the interventions you see here were successful. And if I further went down, then it would show the one that's not completed yet as well. So Webbit use across Ontario right now, there's about 68% of school boards are using it in some capacity. And Webbit's been used since 2004 with over 100,000 students. So and that number is growing. What does the data show? So every year between 15 to 20% of children are flagged and are at risk for future school difficulties. So last year, approximately 40% of that 15 to 20% were no longer flagged as a support that they received through Webbit. We did a lot of research on this, and that's what we just came up with. And this year, the number is proving to be much higher for the 2010-2011 school year. The remaining of students, despite receiving interventions, they're the tier three and may eventually be, are the ones eventually formally identified or are on an IEP later on. Okay, why use it? Quick and easy to administer. It's an effective predicting tool. It provides interventions. And it has great interventions for teachers. This I already kind of went over in the presentation, but also the last one is really important since principals and school boards can access it. Kids are receiving that support at all levels. Okay, so final notes. As we all know, it's at the early years, it's extremely crucial that we focus on this time and that we provide interventions to those students who just really need it. Success in the early years are known to lead to success in the later years, and students who are more successful in secondary school are likely to access higher education. And this often translates into, of course, better jobs, higher cultural rewards, and so forth. Okay, so that was that. I'll take any questions as well as keep information up here if anybody wants anything. Any questions? Yes?
You made reference to flagging, and you showed the normal curve. Are the particular, is this normed? Do you actually have a norm base where you look at the performance of the items based on norm group? Or is it a criterion where you're looking at a specific proficiency band for each child within a class?
It is normed. So that's why, for example, the TSRI, we have cutoffs that are specifically for the age group. So it's a large area. For example, the TSRI, I believe, for SK, for senior kindergarten, the cutoff is 11 out of 14 to get, no, 11 out of 21, I believe. And that benchmark, so it's based off of the norm. It's not specific.
So you went out and normed it so you know a child is in the bottom, let's say, 5 percentile, and that's why you flagged them? You made
yes.
a reference to 5 out of 20 kids.
That's what research, 5 out of 20 kids?
You had a slide, you showed a picture of them.
Oh, yes, that's over in generic research has shown that in a typical classroom, that's the percentage of children who would be at risk if they didn't receive future help or interventions. But it is based off of the norm.
Are the items normed, or is it the actual form of the test per age normed?
The items are normed. The items are normed, yes.
Like the Roche model or something like that?
Sorry?
With the Roche modeling or three-primer IRT or something like that?
Yes, and this is all data that we do have that, for example, the Research Advisory Working Group, another huge acronym, the RAW group, they have done, and they have that norm for each of the items. And that's all something that we do have.
What was the population that the money was derived from? Is it Canada, United States,
Canada? Canada. Ontario, specifically. Sorry?
Yeah.
Specifically Ontario.
Yes.
Oh, when? This was done in 2003, and then the study was also done in 2005, just to ensure that.
You also had reference to validity studies with the Stanford Achievement Test. You didn't have what version of that test?
That I don't have on me, to be honest. I don't. It's in our data package, but I'm not sure what version. Yes. Somebody else had their hand up, I think. Yes.
You said K junior, K senior, I don't know whatever you called it. Do you screen kids upon entering kindergarten and they begin to follow tracks?
So, for example, junior kindergarten is 4 years old, so they would come in, and then they would be screened in the fall, and then junior kindergarten would be screened again in the spring. Yes.
Is this available to other people, like in the United States?
We're currently working on that. We're currently, literally before I left, we're creating a business strategy. Right now we're working on BC and other provinces. We've also been piloted in some of the Native American communities, and it's working really well. And we're slowly seeing interest from the U.S. And yes, we are working on that as we speak.
And the second question is, this seems like a lot of work for the teachers. Do they have time to teach?
that's a good question. You know, we did receive pushback initially, but what we're learning and what they're learning is it's not something set aside. What they're actually seeing, for example, during report card season, this is helping them drive their comments and whatnot. And also, for example, early intervention screening. In Ontario, under PPM, so Policy and Program Policy Memorandum Number 11, it's mandated that all boards use something for early intervention and screening. Now, our program specifically is not mandated, but it is funded through the government. So it's doing, if they're not doing this, they have to do something else.
All right, then the next question is, because I know where I'm working, in every classroom there's 5 kids that aren't doing well, and there's no funding for any early intervention. Do y'all have funding? Like if you identify, say, 5 kids in each classroom, do you have additional teachers that come in and do that intervention?
There is.
Is that funded by your government?
It is funded by the government.
Okay,
yes,
okay.
Special education resource teachers.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Good. Yes. Anything else? Nope, I think we're good.
Wonderful.
All right, wrap it up.
Round of applause.